Yes, I can
Yes.
Hear you.
Okay, so good morning, everyone. So today we have Paolo Giannozzi, who will speak about charge densities and potentials, systems in 0, 1, 2, 3 dimensions, metals, insulators, non-magnetic versus magnetic systems. So before starting the living room to Paolo, just let me say a few things regarding the organization of the of this meeting. So from yesterday's experience, we learned that the Zoom chat is quite ineffective for posting questions, because especially if you post questions during the meeting, during the talk, it is very, very difficult for us to keep track of all the questions. So for today, we would like to try in this way. Please, I would ask you to not write anything in the chat while Paolo is speaking, because so let's keep the chat clean. Then at the end of Paolo's talk, I will ask if someone of you want to do a few questions on speaking. I can enable the microphone for one or two questions on voice. So if you have anything to ask, just keep it in mind. And then at the end of the talk, raise your hand. You have the option in the bottom bar of Zoom, just raise hand. And I will let one or two people to do the question. And then in general, you can, at the end of the talk, you can write all questions in the Zoom chat. So please, let's wait. Don't write anything on Zoom until Paolo finishes his talk. And then when Paolo finishes, write the questions in the chat so that it is easier for us to manage the questions and keep track of all the questions. And so, yes, this is all. So good morning, everybody. And I leave room to Paolo. Please, Paolo.
Okay, good morning to everybody. There is somebody who entered the waiting room and is waiting to be admitted.
I'm admitting him, but there are some issues, but you can continue.
Okay, so we'll ignore the message. So as Ivan was reading the title of my talk, was realizing that I have just collected a bunch of mostly technical issues. So today's talk doesn't have a real well-defined focus. I hope you won't be more confused at the end than at the beginning. Let me show if I manage to my screen. So the first topic I would like to talk about a little bit is Fourier transform. You may have heard yesterday, or you may have seen yesterday in the hands-on that there is this mysterious fast Fourier transform grid that typically is automatically computed by the code, but maybe it's better if you have an idea of what it is and what it is used for. So the basic point is that when you have a periodic function, and we basically always have periodic functions in quantum espresso, in a way or another, the Fourier components of the periodic function here, it's a simple one-dimensional example, the Fourier components are a discrete but infinite set of values. Now we truncate this discrete set and we make it a finite set. So how can we deal with these functions with a finite number of Fourier components? Now, what happens is that you can discretize the problem both in real space and in reciprocal space, and you may associate to the functions in real space a grid of the function and a grid of a finite grid of points, and the same in reciprocal space, and you have then a finite set of points, both in the real space and in the reciprocal space, and a mathematical operation called discrete Fourier transform, which is actually the real Fourier transform specialized to the case of discrete functions. It can be written as I have written here in the slides below. It's a sum over exponential with those numbers here, those factors. The integer index here in both cases runs from zero to some capital N. Capital N that must be large enough to accommodate all the available Fourier transform and Fourier components in reciprocal space. Notice that by construction, both functions, both in real space and in reciprocal space, are periodic. And so, so you have a sort of fictitious periodicity in reciprocal space as well. You actually exploit this fictitious periodicity to refold negative values of vectors of Fourier components. So here you see there are in the definition of the Fourier components, there are no negative values, but the negative values are, so to speak, at the end of the other side of the box. So you have a box in real space, it's your unit cell that is subdivided into points that span the entire, on a uniform grid, that span your entire unit cell. And the same in G space and in reciprocal space, and the components, the negative components, are actually refolded on the side of large values of the index. That's because this function is actually periodic, exactly. Function in Q is periodic exactly as the function in R. And this can be generalized, it's quite straightforward, just a little bit boring, can be generalized to three-dimensional Fourier transform. So you have your G vectors, your reciprocal lattice vectors that are generated by making a linear combination with integer coefficients of your basis vectors. Basis vectors define the reciprocal lattice, so-called reciprocal lattice. And the same for in real space, you have a uniform grid that spans the unit cell defined as shown here below. So these are the grid points on which we know our wave function, our charge density, on which we define our functions. So this discrete Fourier transform, so that the relation between the discrete Fourier transform, the variables in the discrete Fourier transform, and the variables in the original Fourier transform is written here. So from the function in real space, continuous function in real space to three-dimensional grid, and from the Fourier component, the discrete Fourier component, into a discrete grid of Fourier components. So those numbers N1, N2, N3, capital N1, capital N2, capital N3, those numbers must be large enough to accommodate all the available Fourier components. Those Fourier components, you have a sphere of G vectors, you have Fourier components in a sphere of G vectors, and you must be able to accommodate all those components. How many components do we have? Well, for the expansion of Pontian orbitals, we have plane waves up to the famous or infamous kinetic energy cutoff that we decide on the basis of our system, of the system we have. Typically, we choose it on the basis of the pseudo-potential. It's a pseudo-potential that typically, the hardest pseudo-potential that determines which cutoff you should use for the plane wave expansion, for the plane wave basis set. But remember that we have also to, we are using this technology, this machinery of discrete Fourier transform also to compute charge densities and to compute product of the potential times the charge the Pontian orbital. This is an important piece in the calculation, an important part of the calculation. So if you look at how the charge density is defined in reciprocal space, the straightforward definition in terms of expansion coefficient of the expansion of Pontian orbital, so this would be the sum of a psi square written in a reciprocal space, has this form, which is not very practical, but we use it's not actually used. But what you do, you look at, you notice that here in this expansion, there are G vectors up to two times the maximum G vectors that is present here in the expansion of Pontian orbitals. And the same holds for the product of the potential times Pontian orbital. You need the potential up to a maximum G vector of maximum length that is twice the maximum length of the G vector you have for the in the plane wave basis set that you use to expand the Pontian orbital. So finally, this means that if you want to use Fourier transform, discrete Fourier transform grid, we need to use a grid that includes Fourier transform G vectors up to a cutoff that is four times the cutoff needed for just the expansion of plane waves of Pontian orbitals into plane waves. Okay, that's maybe you have already heard, so I'm maybe repeating. Notice, however, I'm going to talk a little bit about this later, that for the specific case of so-called ultrasoft pseudopotential and PAW pseudopotential as well, you may need an additional grid, an additional Fourier transform grid, in order to account for so-called augmentation terms in the charge density. Also notice that this grid, sort of cube in the space of indices, so N1, N2, N3, actually these are the refolded one, N prime, and N prime are the refolded ones, and N are the those that run from 0 to N minus 1, actually from 1 to N, capital N, in the code, because for historical reasons, actually, once upon a time, Fortran arrays started from 1 and ended to some number. So I was saying in this grid, this sort of cube, actually you will have also some empty space. So you will waste some space. So this is a graphical representation. I think I stole this picture from Carlo Cavazzoni slides sometimes ago. In case you don't know, I have difficult relationship with graphics and with slides in general. So from time to time, I steal slides from other people. Anyway, this is the box, the Fourier transform box. And in the case of Comsham states, only, let's say, 1/8, approximately a cube, or 1/8 the volume of the total is actually used, while in the case of charge densities or potentials, you fill with a sphere of G vectors as much as you can of the cube of the Fourier transform grid. This is relatively straightforward. It becomes less straightforward when you start to consider how to execute in parallel, and the parallel algorithm is quite sophisticated and has to take into account this difference between the number of the space field in this case and in this case, and number of G vectors in this case and in this case, and in order to have a uniform distribution of uniform distribution and a good balance, load balance of everything, one has to resort to rather sophisticated algorithms. So there is a computational advantage in using discrete Fourier transform. There wouldn't be such a big computational advantage, but the point is that you can perform the discrete Fourier transform with an algorithm known since many years by now as fast Fourier transform, which is much faster than the plain simple algorithm one can imagine. So the plain algorithm would require order of n points squared. So if you have a Fourier transform on a grid of n points, three dimensional grid containing n points, capital N points, then the ordinary Fourier transform would require N squared. The fast Fourier transform require order of N log N, and that's enormous. That's an enormous advantage that can be exploited, especially in the so-called dual space technique. So in the dual space technique, what you do, what you need actually in most cases are things like most of the calculation is spent in computing products like Hamiltonian time trial wave function minus an energy. But here the difficult part is the Hamiltonian times the trial wave function. This is the basic ingredient of all calculations using iterative techniques, be it Carpanelli molecular dynamics or conventional molecular dynamics or iterative diagonalization, self-consistency plus iterative diagonalization. And the basic ingredient is invariably this object here, H minus epsilon times the trial wave function. Now, this can be done quite easily by looking at the various terms containing the Hamiltonian. So you have a term here that is the kinetic energy, and the kinetic energy is simple in G space. So let's say you compute the G space components, plane waves component. Yeah, you have plane wave components. So the kinetic part is simple. This part here, the local part of the pseudo potential plus the Hartree potential plus the exchange correlation potentials are potentials, are V of R potentials in real space, local potential in real space. So you bring the Comsham orbitals to real space. You make the calculation on the grid, you make the calculation, it's just a calculation, the multiplication is just a multiplication on the grid, it's a local potential times the psi of R, And then you go back to reciprocal space. The final term here, the non-local term, can be written, can be manipulated in such a way that local, the non-local pseudo-potential term can be written as some projectors, and it is fast to compute either in G-space or in reciprocal space. So that's how it works everywhere. Whenever you can use this trick of going to real to reciprocal space, wherever it is more convenient, execute what you need in the most convenient space and back, and go back to the other space, then that's done. That's something that is invariably done everywhere in Quantum Espresso and in similar codes based on a plane wave basis set. Okay, let's move to a different, to slightly different aspect. So you may have seen yesterday that in order to compute the charge density, you have to perform a sum, a finite sum on some set of key points. And these key points are not actually typically given to cover, they are a uniform grid typically, but typically they are not given as a uniform grid on the entire pre-grain zone. But they're given, they may be given only, what is computed actually is only the part of those of key points that are symmetry in equivalent. So you have a set of symmetry operations that of a crystal, and you apply the symmetry operation to a given key point, you obtain what is called the star of the key point, the star of the vector, so all the symmetry equivalent vectors, and you keep one representative per key point, per star, with a weight, the symmetry weight that is proportional to the number of points in the star. Of course, if you sum the charge density, if you compute this quantity, it doesn't have, it may not have the correct symmetry. In general, it hasn't the correct symmetry. So what you do is you symmetrize this quantity. So you apply this operation, you apply the symmetry operation to the unsymmetrized charge density. Sum over symmetry operation. The symmetry operation applied to the charge density gives the charge density in the rotated position with all R rotated, with all vectors rotated, and you sum those. So this is called symmetrization, and it is the reason why we can make all calculations only on a subset of key points. Notice a problem that may not be evident. The way the algorithm current works is that you can either provide, ask for or require an automatic grid, and the code will compute the weights and the respective points automatically for you, or you may provide a list of key points. If you do that, you can, but if you do that, remember that the code assumes that what you are providing is the list of key points that are inequivalent by symmetry with respect of the symmetry of the lattice, the Bravi lattice, not of the crystal. And the code will compute additional, will add additional points if the symmetry is not, is lower than the symmetry of the Bravi lattice. This is sometimes a source of confusion. and of problems in case your list of key points is not given for the correct lattice symmetry. So if you, in case of trouble, use the automatic grid that the code computes. There is a small utility that computes anyway list of key points. It's called key points, in fact. But it does exactly the same calculation. It does exactly the same calculation. So two more remarks. There are symmetry groups that are non-symmorphic, so the symmetry operations are not only rotations, but also fractional translation, fractional with respect to the lattice translation. They may be one half, one third, one fourth, one sixth of a lattice translation. In that case, you have to just to generalize this symmetrization formula. This was a source of trouble for a long time because this fractional translation, being fractional, doesn't guarantee that the translated grid, FFT grid, overlaps the original FFT grids. So it was a source of problem, and occasionally it is still, because this kind of symmetrization in real space is still performed for some specific calculations. In otherwise, what is done, symmetrization is done in G space. It's less transparent and more complex, it's less simple, but it doesn't have any problem with fractional translations. Also notice a detail, the charge density as I have defined here and as it's used in the code is i-dimensional. So it's a charge density containing that integrates, if you make the integral of the unit cell of the charge density, you get the number of electrons. You don't get the number of electrons times the charge. Again, I have mentioned before that in the case of ultra-associated potentials, it's also in the projector augmented way, there is an augmentation term, the charge density. So the charge density is not simply the square of the Consham orbitals, it's the square of the Consham orbitals plus a term that has this form, in which the beta and QLM, these objects that appear here, beta and Q, are part of the definition of the pseudopotential. They are localized functions, localized around the center, around the atomic position, the ionic position, and their short range, and give this additional term. This additional term may be somewhat harder from the point of view of the Fourier transform than this term. So this term can be easily computed on the Fourier transform grid, as I have introduced before. But this term very often, almost invariably actually, requires a cutoff, requires a grid of G vectors, because more slowly in G space than this one. So it requires a grid of G vectors that is larger than the grid of G vectors needed for this part here, for the what is conventionally called the smooth part of the charge density, so the ordinary psi square. So you have to take into account this fact by introducing a second grid that in G space is larger. So you need, in addition to this grid, you need another grid that can fit a sphere in which this radius here, instead of being four times. The radius here is not four times, it's two times. So this maximum length is actually two times. And anyway, the sphere of G vectors that is needed is larger, so you have another Fourier transform grid corresponding to larger sphere and the larger cube. Of course, there is a problem. So in real space, those grids are not necessarily commensurate. So you may have, in general, you have different real space points, real space grids that may not have points in common. So when you need to bring the things from one grid to another, and of course here you, sooner or later you need it because you have this on one grid and this on a different one. What you do is you work in G space. So in G space you have a small sphere for psi square, for instance, and the larger sphere for the augmentation terms. So you can the larger sphere, of course, includes the small sphere. So you bring your G vectors from here to here, and they fit, and you add what is missing. And then you work with the denser real space grid. Okay, so it's a little bit technical, but maybe it's better if you have some idea of what is going on and why also as well. Again, charge densities, you may have heard yesterday, you should have heard yesterday, that in case of metals, in the case in which you have you don't have a clear cut distinction between occupied and empty bands, then you have to and sometimes even if you have you have to resort to some method to deal with the Fermi surface and to deal with occupancy that change from one to zero in the middle of a band. Now, this is done typically, the most straightforward way of doing that. It's not the only one, there is also tetrahedrals, but I'm not going to talk about that, about this. The typical way to deal with metals is to introduce some broadening of levels. So you have a set of discrete Cauchon levels and you broaden them and you compute weights or occupancies that are fractional objects. So run from zero to one. Of course, they are zero, close to zero, far from above the Fermi surface and the Fermi energy and close to one, just below. And they look like an integral of some broadening function with the condition that the sum of our fractional weights, which gives a number of electrons as a function of the Fermi energy, is equal to the number of electrons in my system. Now, one in principle might use the Fermi-Dirac broadening. Fermi-Dirac is physical, it has this form, so why not use that? Just set some finite temperature, 300 Kelvin, for instance. Now, the problem is that in order it's not very practical. This is not very practical because you need a very high temperature in order to be able to use a reasonably small set of key points. So the electron gas is frozen, it's in a degenerate state, it's well known. So you you add at fine room temperature, very little happens to electrons, so they don't differ that much from the zero temperature distribution. And so you have to set a very high temperature, and with that very high temperature, this distribution has quite long tails, so it decays slowly, so you have to include many bands above the Fermi energy. It's not something very practical. So one uses some other broadening functions chosen with the criterion I'm going to explain now. Now, there is an important point you should be aware of. So in the calculation of the total energy, you may take advantage of the sum over one electron states. So you may write the total energy as the sum over one electron states, over Kohn-Sham state, Kohn-Sham levels, one electron levels, minus the Hartree energy minus, because it's counted twice in the sum of Kohn-Sham energies, plus some other terms, we'll see it later, plus or minus some other terms. Now, how do you compute this term, this Kohn-Sham energy? The typical one would think, okay, we have weights here for the charge density. Then we sum the weights times the one electron energies. Well, no, what you have to compute is actually the integral of the energy over the broadening functions, which is almost equal to this, to the sum of weights times Kohn-Sham orbitals, Kohn-Sham energies. But there is a small difference, a small correction. Small correction that the code prints out, calling Smearing contribution. And if you do the math, so if you look at, if you do the calculation of the functional derivative of this energy and this energy, and you in all other terms, of course, you will find that the functional derivative of this energy is the correct one. It's the one that is minimized by this charge density. And the forces are derivatives of this energy, not of this energy. So that's why this contribution is actually important. Now, broadening functions can be chosen. There is a various theories on what the optimal choice of broadening function. The simplest one is a Gaussian, like this one, a normalized Gaussian. It's not very convenient, actually. What happens is that ideally you should compute. You should use a broadening delta, the sigma, sorry. Sigma is the object that is called D-Gauss in the code, and you have to provide it in Rydberg. And it's defined exactly in this way. It's a sort of fictitious temperature. You may think that this broadening introduces a fictitious temperature T equal to sigma divided by the Boltzmann constant. And you may think that the energy that you get is a sort of free energy, sort of fictitious free energy functional, the function of sigma. So I was saying it is, in principle, one should use a sigma as small as possible and as few key points as possible. Of course, the two things don't go in different directions. So the smallest the broadening, the more key points you will need, and vice versa. So it's your interest is to use as large as possible sigma broadening. Assume that you have a given budget for computation, that's what you have to do. If you can afford that many key points, then you have to choose a sigma broadening that makes your calculation converge with those key points you can afford. Now, the problem is that this fictitious energy grows as with sigma, as a sigma squared. So the difference, the error that it introduces in the energy, in the forces, in everywhere, is not that small. For large broadening, you have a large error as well. So there are these two kind of smart broadening, so called Metzfessel-Paxton and Margiari-Vanderbilt. Nicola Margiari is a good friend of us, so I'm morally obliged to advise for Margiari-Vanderbilt co-smearing. And those smart smearing are devised to reduce the dependency of the energy, of the fictitious free energy, which of course corresponds to the two energy at sigma equals zero. They have smart smearing techniques have a weak dependence upon sigma, so they allow to use larger values of the program. You may find in this page some detailed explanation by Nicola Margiari. Something that was always known, but was recently remarked and finally fixed, is that under some conditions, those smart broadening functions may lead to a bad choice of the Fermi energy. The problem is that those smart broadening are not smart enough to avoid that occupancy may have unphysical values. So physical values are from zero to one. Metzfessel-Paxton may have negative occupancies or larger than one. And Margiari-Vanderbilt is non-negative, but may be larger than one, which means that if you look at the number of electrons as a function of the energy, that is the function I have introduced before somewhere here, this number of electrons as a function of the position of the Fermi energy is not a monotonic function, which means that you may, under some unfortunate circumstances, get a wrong Fermi energy. So there can be more than one Fermi energies. That's the point. This has been fixed very recently by collaborator Nicola Margiari. Okay, again, for charge density, what happens in the non-magnetic, magnetic, and collinear magnetic case? In the non-magnetic case, you have all orbitals occupied by two electrons up and down. So you simply have the total charge density as twice the sum over the square of the orbitals times the occupancies. Of course, in case of ultrasoft pseudo potential, here you have also the augmentation term. I haven't written it explicitly because it's, but for simplicity, it doesn't change anything. In the case of collinear polarization, so the so-called LSDA, local spin density approximation, which is not necessarily local. It's an old name, but anyway, what is important here is not the L, but the S. So in that case, which is the most common case of magnetization, you have orbitals that have either spin up or spin down. So in that case, you define a charge density, a total charge density, that is the sum of the total charge, of the charge density coming from spin up orbitals, plus the charge density coming from spin down orbitals. And you have magnetization, which is a scalar. It's a difference between the two, n plus minus n minus. Notice also that there isn't a spin index in quantum espresso. This is not, it's not used. Well, in Carparinello, it is used actually. In quantum espresso, in the self-consistent code, what we do actually is to hide this spin polarization index into key points. So we have our set of key points. We double it. The first set of key points has a Consham orbital. We spin up. The second set of key points has a Consham orbital. We spin down. So unpolarized case, one charge density, one array of charge density. Spin polarized case, LSDA, two charge density and magnetization. What happens in this called non-collinear magnetic case? In the non-collinear magnetic case, we have a plane wave basis set that is composed of plane waves times spin on, so up and down. So basis set is doubled. So you have vector of components for each orbital that have a spin index. So the vector for spin up and the vector for spin down. And so in addition to the total charge density, which is simply the sum over all the components, there's also a magnetization, a vector of magnetization. I have written here explicitly the arrow to make it clear that it is a vector magnetization, in which the magnetization is computed from the matrix elements of Pauli matrices. So this sigma here, this vector of matrices are the three Pauli metrics. Now about potentials, something that one has to be aware of is that we are dealing with an infinite system, within infinite system, so some potential terms are divergent. In particular, the G equals zero component of the potential, of the electrostatic potential generated by the electron, so the Hartree term is by construction infinite. In fact, if you look at its form in G space, you see that the Hartree potential is the charge density in G space divided by G square times some 4 pi omega something. But of course, for G equals zero, this diverges. And the local part of the electron ion, pseudo ion interaction also diverges. So the minus Z valence Z times charge square divided by R term, the Coulomb term, give rise to the interaction that, again, it has a form of 1 over g squared of z valence number of valence electrons divided by g squared, and so it diverges as well. But for for neutral system, there are no divergences. The potential does not diverge. Other terms, instead of short range terms that don't have this problem of divergence and can be computed quite in quite straightforward way. Again, something that should be remarked is that those potentials are actually potential energies. So in the code, we use energies. We multiply the potentials by the charge density, the electron charge density, absolute value, not with the sign. And so they are energies, and they have the dimensions of energies, Rydberg-Hartree atomic units. This is how the potential look like in a specific case, a silicon. You see that the potential may vary quite a bit. And the sum of the various terms, there are terms that tend to compensate here in particular, electron ion interaction potential, the local part here in red, is heavily compensated by the exchange correlation close to the nuclei in silicon. I haven't mentioned about the exchange correlation potential in this case, actually, in the non-collinear magnetic case. It's quite tricky because you have basically there are no exchange correlation potential for this form here. So functionals of the charge density and of the magnetization vector. So you have to choose a direction. And in each point, you choose a direction of the magnetization. You look at the components of the magnetization up and down, and you use exchange correlation functional of the local charge and the local magnetization. The problem is with GGA, in which you have a gradient, and the gradient is not necessarily in the same direction of the local magnetization, so it's quite tricky. Okay, and again, now after potentials that move to energies, as I mentioned before, the total energy can be written as the sum over one electron energies. That's the term we have seen before, and we've seen before how it must be computed for metals, minus the Hartree energy, the electrostatic Hartree energy, repulsive energy between average repulsive energy between electrons. This one, of course, is also divergent. It has a G equals zero divergence. So what you subtract out here is a term without, is the energy, the Hartree energy without that term. Then we subtract out the exchange correlation term here, it is not the correct one, and we add back the exchange correlation term, which is the correct one. This is not problematic at all. But then we have the energy, electron-electron, ion-ion interaction energy, of course, again, divergent. Again, we remove the divergence by considering the interactions of nuclei in a background, in a neutralizing background. Now, there are several divergent terms here. So one is here and it's removed. Another one is here, it's removed. Another one is hidden here, it's in the potential. It is also removed. And so all these terms in a neutral system cancel out. All these divergent terms cancel out, and the total energy is well defined. Now, for a periodic system, so what happens is that the energy per cell is well defined, but you can't have a net charge. It's well defined for neutral systems. If the system is not neutral, if there is a net charge on the cell, the energy per cell diverges. There is nothing one can do about that. More exactly, there is something one does about that. It's just throwing away the divergence. So you have, you treat the charged cell as if it were neutral for what concerns the divergence term, the divergent term. So, first consequence of the periodicity, net charge on a unit cell equal trouble. Second consequence, well, of course, the potentials have to be periodic as well. So they have a periodicity of the lattice, which means that there can be no macroscopic electric field. Macroscopic electric field is described by potential like this with E electric field, and it's something that cannot be present in a periodic system. So no macroscopic electric field. More exactly, there are techniques to simulate the macroscopic electric field. Some are based on the so-called modern theory of polarization. Some are slightly more tricky. We'll briefly describe one later, especially for slabs in the so-called slab geometry. So when you have a supercell of alternating layers of material and empty and of a vacuum like for a surface, in that case you may simulate an electric field by adding a potential that has this form in the region you are interested in, and then it goes back to the periodic form in the region in the vacuum where nothing interesting happened. A more intriguing problem with periodicity is that the zero of the energy, so the zero, actually the zero of the potential, the V potential at G equals zero is arbitrary. So in particular, it has no direct relation with the vacuum level, so the zero energy of an empty space. Okay, there is no outside, so the crystal extends periodically everywhere, and so there is no outside a crystal. So absolute values of Compsham eigenvalues, for instance, have no direct meaning. They can be whatever. It depends upon the arbitrary value of the potential, of the zero of the potential. Finally, also dipoles are not well defined in general. So for a finite system, you can easily find the electronic dipole from the charge density. So you just compute R times charge density and N of R. Well, maybe here I should have added the charge, the electron charge. Well, the ionic potential, the ionic dipole is easy, straightforward, and that's it. But in a periodic system, what you compute in this way depends upon what you choose for the periodicity. So in this case, we have the dipole here and the dipole here. Apparently here the dipole points towards the left from minus to plus. But if you look at a different choice of a cell, here the dipole points in the opposite direction. Of course, if you are dealing with a finite system with a supercell, then the dipole may be well defined. In that case, you have the possibility to define a dipole by considering only cell that include one copy of your finite system. So as long as you have a prescription to divide, so subdivide your crystal into units, then the dipole of that unit is well defined. The problem is that for finite system, you have a clear prescription in general. In this case, for instance, you may assume this as your unit cell or this, and they give different values of the dipole. So as I was mentioning before, it's not impossible to deal with charged system. One has to be careful. Actually the code does it automatically because automatically it sets the divergences at g equals zero to zero as if the system were neutral. But what you may find is that the actual value of the energy you get in this way depends upon the choice of the zero of the potential. And you may notice that, for instance, in the self-consistent code, pw.x, you will get for a system some value. You perform the same calculation for the Carparinello code, which uses a different choice of the zero of the potential, you get a different number in addition to the factor of two, because the Carparinello code prints results in Hartree and the self-consistent code prints the results in Rydberg. So you have to be very careful not to compare and you cannot simply compare energies with different charge states. You have to resort to some tricks. You have to align the G vectors, the G equals zero potentials, and you have to, in any way, the result will always depend upon the energy you may. Typically, you have a reservoir of charges at a given chemical potential, and then the result, the stability will depend upon the energy, the chemical potential of the reservoir of charges. Another fact that is not sure it's really relevant in practice, but in principle, due to this dependence upon the choice of that is dependence upon an arbitrary potential, there is no guarantee that if you perform a structural optimization calculation in a charge system, what you get is sensible. In practice, I have no evidence that this doesn't happen, but there is no guarantee, let's say. Let's come back to finite systems. So for instance, to molecules treated with supercell and periodic boundary conditions, of course, having a supercell approach has many advantages, but it also has some disadvantages. In particular, you may have a spurious interaction between periodic replicas of your system. You are interested in an isolated system in a molecule. You have an infinite array of such systems. what guarantee is that what you get from this infinite array is valid also for a single one? Well, nothing, but if the isolated system have no dipole or are not charged or have no dipole, the interaction between periodic replicas, the spurious interaction between periodic replicas vanishes quite quickly. It's sufficient to have a few Armstrong of empty spaces between periodic replicas and you get basically converged results. But it's not always possible. And in particular, if you have a charged system, it becomes a problem in case of when you have a charged system, or even if you have a dipole. So the dipolar interaction between dipoles decays quite slowly, and you may notice that just increasing the size of the supercell doesn't help that much. It helps, but it takes very large supercells. Now, there are several approaches. The first two are implemented in quantum espresso, the third is not. The simplest one is a correction on the energy, in which you use an electrostatic model to take the spurious interactions out from the results. You correct just the energy, which is in principle not completely correct, because the presence of periodic images also affects the potential. There's a way to correct the energy and the potential as well, by cutting the Coulomb potential in reciprocal space. So Coulomb potential is responsible for the long rangeness, of course, of the interactions. You may implicitly you may cut off the Coulomb potential, and if you cut off the Coulomb potential, what is beyond a given distance is just invisible. So this is what is actually done in the third cases, in the so-called Hockney method. You cut off the Coulomb potential, but you do that only in the Hartree potential. You do that only in the Hartree potential because it's the only one that is long range. So when you compute the potential, the V of H, you cut the Coulomb potential. It can be done in a more simple way also in reciprocal space. So you cut off it's equivalent to cut off the real in reciprocal space. It's more sort of equivalent. It's called the Martina-Tarkovan approach. And this is actually implemented. Let's see. The simplest case is a Markov-Penn correction. In the Markov-Penn correction, let's assume that you have a cell, a cubic cell of size L, capital L. So one can study the convergence of a system without dipole, no charge and no dipole. It converges as the fifth power of minus one over the fifth power of the unit cell, on the cell side, so quickly. With a dipole, it converges as one over the cube of the length of the side of the cube, so more slowly. And for a charged system, it converges at one over L. So it converges never, basically. And this is also difficult. So the one writes down correction that has this form. It's a sort of Madelung for charge, if there is a net charge, one removes the Madelung energy of the array of net charges, and one removes the dipolar equation in, I hope I've written it correctly. No, I haven't, it's L cube, of course, because this one, it's L cube. And then one finds that the energy converge quite quite well to, much better to expected result. For surfaces one typically uses a slab approach. So you have a piece of surface, a piece of some empty space, and it is periodically repeated. Of course, you have to make some serious convergence study with respect to both the dimension of the slab, of the number of layers that you consider for your surface, and the number of the amount of empty space to leave in order to reproduce an isolated surface. So one side of the surface shouldn't see what happens on the other side of the cell. And inside, in the middle of the slab, the material should behave sufficiently close to the real crystal. Okay, that's something that one has to, depends a lot upon the specific material and the specific problem. One has to do some specific, some convergence, some careful convergence study for this. This is an example, the recent example I've taken from work I've also contributed to. This guy is a postdoc at electronic engineering here in Udine. He performed first calculation of gold, of a gold surface. So the black one, this is what? This is the potential energy actually, the local part. Of course, you can't represent the non-local part. Average in the plane. So this is a function of the Z components, of the vertical components, orthogonal to the surface and the plane. And it's averaged in XY, in the XY direction. So here you have the gold, and here you have those oscillations. And outside you see the behavior of the potential, it's flat. Notice the values here, electron volts. And here outside, we are at 8 to 9 EVs. So the zero is 9 degrees, apparently is 8 EVs or so. But again, this is not important because this zero is arbitrary. But of course, once you have a function, and once you have a slide like that, a slab like that, then you may, for instance, compute the work function. So the energy needed to take an electron out from here to here, you may find what the average of the potential is inside the material, and then refer the one electron states to the average value here. And then you have the energy that is needed to remove an electron from the metal and to bring it in the empty space. Now, in addition to gold here, there is, after the first calculation with gold alone, we have added some molybdenum disulfide, it's a very fashionable material, quasi by the b-dimensional material. And the interest was in starting contacts with molybdenum disulfide on various metals. The molybdenum disulfide is on this side, of course. And now you see that what happens is that this is a polar material, and this polar material produces a dipole. And this dipole can be evaluated by looking at this called dipole correction. So it's something that the code can compute. One adds a compensating dipole. So if you don't do anything, yet the potential, instead of being flat, is curved. You may add this compensating dipole here in the region of empty space where nothing happens. It brings the potential that causes the potential to become flat again on this side and this side. And this gives information on the actual dipole that is present on the surface. Okay, I think I finished here. Something I wanted to talk about, but I haven't prepared a slide, is about application of electric fields. You may, in a case like that, consider, for instance, the black one, the black lines. How can you apply an electric field here on this material? Well, you add a source of potential like that. That in this region, in the region of empty space, of course, it has to be periodic, so it goes down, and then it repeats periodically. So the potential is simulates an electric field here in the region of the material, and then simulates something that is completely unphysical, of course, in the empty space, but you aren't interested in what happens in the empty space. Of course, the potential, the overall potential is periodic, and it's made periodic by reverting it in a region far away from the material. A frequent mistake is to misunderstand where the empty space is and to give parameters that make the electric field to change direction in the middle of the materials instead of the middle of empty space. So be careful when you do that. Okay, I think I've finished for now.
Thank you very much, Paolo. So we have, it's 10 to 10. So I think we have quite an amount of time for questions. So if whoever wants to ask a question directly speaking on voice, you can raise your hand. You have the button in the lower. Okay, here we have one. So Daniel Torres, please.
Hello. Thank you, Professor Giannossi, for such an beautiful, calm and detailed talk. And my question is the next. I've read and watched a lot of videos on DFT, and they talk about these correlation problems on the on DFT. Would you say this is more of a user or a code problem?
Sorry, what is exactly the correlation problem? The choice of an axis correlation potential, you mean?
Because I've read papers where they say that this is a correlation problem in DFT. It's misrepresented correlations between electrons.
Well, it's true that when people don't find the correct results, they say, "Oh, it's correlation." Well, depends a little bit about the materials for which the materials and the properties for which this correlation problem is invoked. So there are some well-known cases of DFT failures, or maybe you heard about that when tomorrow or on when is the advanced functional stuff?
The day after tomorrow, Thursday.
Okay, Thursday, there is a day dedicated to advanced functionals. And of course, when you talk about advanced functionals, you have to specify what backwards functional don't get right. And there are a number of known problems in DFT, in plain simple DFT, let's say. And also of known known measures to known things that can be done to avoid those problems. So it's one should have a look at the specific case. I mean, for instance, the lack of van der Waals interactions in DFT, in plain DFT, let's say GGA, may be tracked to missing electronic correlation, actually missing non-local correlations between clouds of charge that are do not overlap or overlap in a marginal way. That's more or less known, and it's also more or less known what to do in that case. Use van der Waals aware functionals or add corrections, various kind of corrections. Not sure I've answered your question.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Daniel. So, of course, now you can write all your questions in the Zoom chat. I see there is another raised hand, Dorie Estera. Please.
Hello. Good morning from Spain. Thank you for the invitation for this wonderful school and also for this wonderful talk. I was thinking about the clear explanation you did about the charge density, and I have seen in literature that often some of these effects are not introduced in the self-consistent cycle. I think, for example, in magnetism or in spin orbit coupling in the case of non-collinear magnetic calculations. Sometimes these effects are introduced in a tie binding model at the end of the calculations. And this, of course, allows to low expensive calculations and makes possible to converge some calculations that are really difficult to converge. So is this a good practice? Or are we losing something important? Because I understand we would be using a charge density that is far away from the real physics.
It's a good practice if it works. I haven't mentioned this, but non-collinear magnetization is a pain in the to converge. I mean, it's hard to converge. And also spin orbit. Spin orbit, when you have spin orbit, typically things are a little bit better. Okay, non-collinear magnetization without spin orbit is not that physically not not very, very sensible because the magnetic isotropy comes from a spin orbit. It doesn't come from directly from the exchange correlation functional. And but I'm aware I don't know very well what how spin orbit works in quantum espresso, but I think it's implemented the proper way, in a complete way. So you start from a pseudo potential with a spin orbit term, and you perform the self-consistency with everything, on everything, on all terms that are there. It's expensive and slow to converge, it's true. I remember that some guy years ago presented an alternative way to, in particular, to compute band structure. It was sort of perturbation. And from what he showed, it was much faster and results were quite good, very good. So it might be a good good alternative in cases which you have really convergence is difficult.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for your answer.
Thank you, Dorian. So I don't see any other raised hand. Yes, there is another one, but maybe let's read a few questions from streaming and then we will have another, the question from Ignacio. So from streaming, I see there are two quite similar questions. One is what materials will provide the cases where MP or MV smearing will provide a non-unique Fermi energy, i.e. when the materials is X, Y, Z. And the other question, I think it is quite related, how should I decide when to choose fixed occupation, fractional occupation, and type of smearing for bad metals, excitonic insulators with pseudo gap?
Case of non-unique for energy, I think the guy who made the found the fix will publish it soon. So if you look in GitHub, in GitLab on the developers portal, there is an issue that now is closed. I'm not sure I can find it now because it's quite old. This was observed some time ago. Typical case in which some trouble could arise is when you have a single state. What was the case? That is for true metals. It doesn't happen. It might happen when you had very few states contributing to the Fermi to the density of state at the Fermi energy. So when you have very few states, in that case, you may occasionally get the bad Fermi energy. It's not a big problem, but it was sometimes some failures have been tracked to a problem like that. About the choice of fixed occupation, fractional occupation, but yeah,
how should I decide to choose fixed occupation, fractional occupation, and type of smearing?
For no, I see it on the chat. Typically, even for insulators, sometimes you need to specify a broadening, because during the self-consistency you may have level crossing, and so your system may become metallic during self-consistency, or you may have level crossing, and so you run into trouble with convergence, self-consistency convergence. So typically, whatever problematic, if your system is problematic, you have to go for fractional occupations for broadening.
So we have another question regarding exchange correlation potential. Are there some approximations for exchange correlation potential or hybrid functional to solve that term? And the term is meant to be the exchange correlation potential in the Consham Hamiltonian. So are there some approximations for exchange correlation potential or hybrid functional to solve the exchange correlation? Maybe
to solve that term.
The term is the exchange correlation potential in the Consham Hamiltonian. So maybe Christian, could you write it better, maybe specifying better which term do you mean? Because it sounds, are there approximations to solve exchange correlation potential? Are there approximations? Okay, so maybe let's try to write the questions a bit more specific. And we have another question later. I have two related questions regarding the corrections for finite systems with PBC. Could you possibly comment on finite side scaling instead of such corrections?
Well, both are good. You can use both. That is, you use correction and finite side scaling. Correction help finite side scaling. Finite side scaling with charged systems, well, try and you will realize that it doesn't work. So you require so large supercells. But anyway, it can be used, yes. How do I use the correction already implemented in Quantum Espresso? Well, this one has to look a little bit carefully to the documentation and to examples, if there are some. Not sure there are many examples, but there must be some example here and there for each of these corrections. Of course, you have to activate those corrections and look at with some flag in the input, and you have to look at parameters, if there are any. For instance, for the electric field, you have to be very careful to where you put your electric field, your reversal of electric field.
So we have time for other questions. Another from streaming: does the charge density symmetrization can be affected by Ibrav equals zero?
And no, in principle, no, because the code anyway will try to figure out what the correct symmetry. In practice, it may happen sometimes that system has trouble in finding the correct symmetry, because what you have provided is almost symmetric. It's an old problem. If you have a real symmetric material with a non-symmetry, you should provide the correct symmetry. It makes life easier. But in principle, it should work anyway. How can we examine effect of electrons, holes? Is it just enough to add, remove an electron? No. Unfortunately, no. You have to take into account. Well, it depends on which effect you are looking at. So effect on geometry with the caveat I have mentioned, you just add or remove an electron and let the system relax with the caveat that, or effect on the electronic structure is something that you can easily see if you remove an electron where it comes from and if you add one where it goes.
On the constant Hamiltonian, we have the exchange correlation potential, which approaches are used to solve it.
The exchange correlation potential is a function of the charge density. So what do you need? You need a local, you have typically local density part, which you have some function of the local density. So you compute the density, the charge density, and you compute directly the potential. This will be a function in real space that you can transform back to reciprocal space if you need it. Actually, you don't. For the GGA part, you have a function of the local density and of the local gradient, square gradient, or some combinations. Anyway, it is something internal to exchange correlation potential. So you have the charge density in real space, for instance, because you sum over psi square in real space because it's convenient. Then you go to reciprocal space and multiply by G, and that's the gradient. You go back to real space, and that's the gradient in real space. Then you have the charge in real space, the gradient in real space, and the function that at each point, using the charge density in that point and the gradient in that point, produces the exchange correlation potential. The more sophisticated the exchange correlation potential is, the more the passage from charge density to exchange correlation potential is complex, is so-called meta-GGA have an additional term in the Hamiltonian that, again, must be computed based on the charge density, again, with similar techniques. Hybrid functionals are much more complex because they have a non-local term that is completely different and must be computed with a rather different technique. But plain exchange correlation functional GGA simply functions of local density and charge density and gradient of the charge density. It's something that you have in input. You compute the gradient using the FFTs. That's it. Well, the functions may be sometimes quite complex and sometimes also numerically noisy, especially in empty space when you have the charge density that is small, the gradient that is small, and the potential should go to zero. It does for atoms analytically, it doesn't for condensed matter system.
Okay, but so
that's it. It's nothing especially complex.
Yeah,
Are we late?
We have 2-3 minutes left. Maybe we can let Ignacio ask his question and then we close. So please, Ignacio.
Thank you. I would like to know what would be your approach to modeling paramagnetic phases in DFT. I know it's somewhat ill-defined and people usually resort to non-magnetic calculations for a paramagnetic material, which I don't find very satisfactory. So what would be your take on this?
What do you mean by paramagnetic materials? Some examples?
A material beyond its critical temperature, where the magnetism is not magnetically ordered anymore.
Well, something, I don't know if it has been said explicitly, is that these calculations in principle are T equals zero calculations.
Yes, yes, of course.
So, so you cannot directly account for the temperature. So you may, for instance, you might consider supercells with some randomly oriented spin, because this is something that can be done actually with non-collinear magnetism. You can impose constraints on the magnetization. Typically you have to, otherwise the system doesn't converge. So you might in principle take a system and make a supercell with a randomly oriented spin or magnetic moments. Otherwise, I don't know. One can always, typically what one tries to do with magnetism is to obtain parameters for an effective Hamiltonian and then use the effective Hamiltonian at high temperature for calculations of statistical mechanical properties.
Yes. Okay, thank you very much.
So thank you very much, Paolo. And now we are really late and we have to close. You can still forward your questions in the proper Slack channel of day two. And we meet again at 10:30 for the hands-on session from Professor Anton Kokal.